sayings of the trade of course is often, in my view, misleadingly or erroneously referred to as a memory exercise. It's nothing to do with a memory exercise. Your memory comes into it, but that is not what you are exercising. You're using your memory, but you're not exercising your memory. What you are doing is training yourself to concentrate on what somebody else has said. Part of that entails the use of your memory, but the object of the exercise is not to use. And in the first two or three, or ideally by 4 weeks, if you are working with that, or the inverse, you learn a lot about how to concentrate on what somebody else is saying. That is very straightforward. I'm not saying it's easy to do, but it's a very straightforward task. You see, they have to say, right, I'm going to listen to what the person is saying, see how this idea fits in with the idea that preceded it, contrasts with it, anticipate what the conclusion will be to the speaker draws. You will learn in that period, if anything, well, to be intellectually involved with somebody else's thought processes. And then it'll come along with this complicated factor, which is, you know, the aim of which is to make the job easier. But very often, the immediate effect of it is to make the job difficult. Because under the pressure of having to listen to something and take a look at the same time, something has to give, and that something tends to be the attention that you devote to what you are hearing. Because you have got this additional complicating factor, which is taking notes, which is something with which you are unfamiliar to begin with. Plus, it's something that you tend to think is the object of the exercise. You tend to think, certainly if you first start taking notes, that it is an end in itself. All I can say is that with practice you will come to realize, if you haven't realized already, that it is only a means to an end. And proof of that is that when you do the exercises, nobody will be in the least bit interested in your notes. Nobody will want to come and have a look and see what you know for the sake of saying that. They may want to come and have a look and see what you know because you wasn't wrong. Because you didn't actually do justice to the speaker. Because you said the opposite of what he intends. Because you created an entirely different impression on that the speaker was able to do. What we're interested in is ensuring that you have a system, your own. There's no framework system. You have an approach, if you like, to note taking, which enables you to do the job that you're here to do, which is to convey somebody else's ideas. With the same conviction, the same intentions, as the person. The way it should be is that you are able.
Jadi apa yang dikatakan oleh narasumber bahwa di sini narasumber ingin menerangkan beberapa prinsip dasar tentang bagaimana kita melakukan thinking sewaktu kita ada dalam perspektif writing. Namun sebelum itu ada beberapa hal yang sering menjadi kesalahan bagi seorang yang masih belajar dalam notaking ini, yaitu adalah yang pertama bahwa mereka itu fokus untuk melatih ingatan. Justru ini menjadi sebuah kesalahan bagi para pelajar karena fokus kita bukan untuk melatih ingatan, tapi kita tetap menggunakan ingatan, tetapi kita tidak harus terus melatih ingatan. Yang kedua adalah bagaimana kita harus fokus terhadap beberapa atau fokus terhadap apa yang menjadi ide pokok dari apa yang disampaikan oleh pembicara. Karena apabila kita fokus terhadap hal yang lain, itu tentu akan sulit bagi kita. Kalau misalkan kita fokus terhadap sesuatu yang justru darinya ingin membantu kita seperti marketing tadi. Jadi kita itu menggunakan marketing bukan untuk sebagai fokus utama kita dalam marketing, tapi justru keputusan kita harus ada pada ide yang dibawa oleh pembicara. Terus yang selanjutnya, hal yang mesti diingat adalah bahwa ini berkaitan dengan nomor poin sebelumnya, bahwa ketika kita justru fokus terhadap marketing itu sendiri, misalnya kita akan membuat sesuatu yang bisa mempermudah itu menjadi sebuah kesulitan yang baru bagi kita. Soalnya kita tahu justru ketika di dalam sebuah tekanan ataupun pressure dari adanya pressure dari adanya waktu yang cukup singkat itu, kita tidak mungkin untuk menulis semua yang disampaikan, tapi kita hanya menulis beberapa bagian yang sekiranya akan sulit untuk diingat untuk kita. Sehingga apabila kita justru fokus terhadap materi itu akan menghilangkan beberapa data yang sangat penting bagi kita untuk menangkap ataupun menyampaikan ide sebenarnya yang ingin disampaikan oleh pembicara. Kembali kan sesuatu yang paling penting itu adalah berarti ketika kita sudah mengetahui itu, kita pasti bakal mengetahui bahwa sebenarnya yang penting adalah konsentrasi terhadap ide pembicara, bukan karena teknik. Sehingga di sini teknik itu menjadi sebuah bagian dari sistem dan juga pendekatan kita untuk menyampaikan sesuatu kepada audiens. Jadi ini merupakan sebuah bagian dari proses interpretasi itu sendiri.
Raising your knee,
feeling the pain and saying, I'm not going to go through that again, I'm going to learn how to keep my balance. So that's the equivalent, if you like, of starting with a listening concentration, exercising with no notepad. And that means that we still have the notepad up our sleeves. And when we introduce the notepad, it can have the effect of giving you a set of gears on the bicycle. Set of big gears so that you can cope with uphill, downhill, flat, whatever kind of terrain. And jumping is a dynamic activity. It's not static. It is constantly on the move. And you as the interpreter have to be constantly on the move along with the speaker whose thoughts you are having to interpret. Okay. So how can
kita harus memberikan sebuah atensi yang berlebih terhadap data-data mekanis seperti number ataupun hal-hal lain yang sekira penting, dan itu merupakan tugas dari marketing untuk mencatatnya. Yang selanjutnya, kita harus mengetahui bahwa yang namanya interpreting itu adalah proses aktivitas dinamik, artinya bukan sesuatu yang berjalan di tempat, artinya dinamik terus berjalan seiringan dengan apa yang dibicarakan oleh atau seiringan dengan ide pemikiran yang dibicarakan oleh narasumber, sehingga kita tidak harus takut terhadap sesuatu yang kaku gitu. Jadi kita harus kita hanya ditugaskan untuk menangkap ide-ide pokok yang ingin disampaikan oleh para narasumber untuk kita sampaikan kembali kepada audiens. Ibaratnya seperti kita ketika kita menggunakan sepeda. Kalau misalkan kita ketika belajar menggunakan sepeda, yaitu kita selalu menggunakan roda kecil untuk melakukan roda kecil untuk menyeimbangkan badan kita. Tapi sebenarnya yang namanya marketing itu di dalam belajar sepeda itu ibaratkan sebuah gear, tahu gear, ibaratkan sebuah gear. Jadi gear ketika ini dilepaskan, kita bisa masih tetap stabil dengan sepeda tersebut. Jadi dengan menggunakan apa? Dengan adanya gear, sehingga kita tidak mungkin terjatuh kalau misalkan kita sudah lihai menggunakan gear tersebut atau dan menjaga keseimbangan, sehingga baik itu di jalanan yang tinggi atau jalan darat, kita masih tetap bisa untuk melaju.
Taking notes help us better to do justice to somebody else's ideas. I think the only way to go about this is to ask a few questions. Why, where, when, what, and how? If we answer those five questions, we've got all fully worked out. Don't see all those questions. Why do we know? Anybody got any suggestions? Why? Well, because we want to risk it. Positive. It's to relieve the strain on our memory. So that's why we know. Particularly things like, one of the things that we absolutely have to watch, things that we find very difficult, if not impossible to remember. Numbers. Names. Technical terms. Things which have no intrinsic meaning. And therefore don't form part of an overall idea. They need to be in their own. So that kind of thing you need to note. But we also note the structure of the speech. The way in which one idea led to another, or the process of another. Basically, we want to end up with on a note there, is the essentials of the argument put forward by the speaker. So, the answer to the question, why do we note, is simple. It enables us to do a better job. Make less of a strain in doing our job. Don't forget, and be working on 6, 7, or 8 hours of the strips. Hopefully, after working in consecutive, but it can happen. And, if you don't have a system of note taking with which you are comfortable, that can tell you that within a couple of hours you will be like a wet dishwasher, you will be exhausted. So you have to have something that enables you to do your job. That's why we note. Why do we note? It's obvious that you've all got a notepad there.
Setelah kita mengetahui beberapa hal yang harus diperhatikan ketika kita perlu belajar note taking, kita akan selanjutnya membahas tentang bagaimana sebenarnya note taking ini bisa membantu kita ketika melakukan consecutive interpreting. Yang pertama adalah dengan mengetahui kenapa kita harus melakukan note taking. Ini menjadi sebuah pemahaman dasar bagi kita yang sedang mempelajari note-taking itu sendiri sebagai bagian dari interpreting. Yang pertama adalah kenapa kita melakukan interpreting, yaitu karena kita sering lupa. Artinya ada beberapa hal yang akan sulit diingat bagi manusia ataupun akan sangat riskan untuk diingat, seperti nomor, terus nama, terus definisi-definisi, terus dan yang lainnya. Selain itu ada juga hal yang harus diingat, dan ini bagi manusia terkadang sangat tidak jarang lupa. Artinya kita harus melakukan teknik, yaitu ketika kita harus mencatat struktur dari perkataan. Artinya gini, ketika berbicara mengenai satu ide, dan nantinya akan mencatat ide lain, kita itu harus bisa mencatat itu supaya nantinya kita bisa menangkap apa sebenarnya pesan yang ingin disampaikan oleh narasumber dengan melihat ataupun dengan mencatat ide-ide tersebut, supaya nanti menjadi satu rangkaian yang utuh.
On a piece of paper or whatever, the back of the menu if you're having to do a speech at a dinner, ideally on the notepad. And ideally too, I don't have to say this, from my point of view, ideally on an unlined notepad. I don't like these notepads because they are lined, and we don't need the lines. They serve no purpose whatsoever. In my opinion, we'll be far better off with just blank pages. But apparently they are very hard to come by these days, notepads, blank pages, so you actually do with these lined ones. You should be as generous as you want to be with the paper you're given. I know we are living in times of budget austerity and all that, but I don't think they've yet to cut that on the notepads. And certainly, as an interpreter, if you need more space in order to write your notes, then you must use more space. Some people are very, very economical in the amount of paper that they use. Other people, they use one page per idea. People sometimes in one page for a couple of words and not the next page. It's horses, it's whatever you feel comfortable with. The one thing to remember, of course, is that what you do on the notepad is no downtime. The notepad is not where you analyze things. That's where you analyze things. The analysis has to take place before something was there. That leads on logically to the next question. When do we note?
Di mana? Sekarang yang kedua adalah ngobrolin di mana? Di mana kita harus melakukan note taking? biasanya dalam catatan. Nah, catatan itu terkadang ada orang yang suka melakukan notaking pada kertas yang ada garis-garis itu. Dan yang kedua ada orang yang suka melakukan notaking pada kertas yang kosong. Dan yang lebih bagus adalah kertas yang kosong. Karena kalau misalkan di dalam kertas yang ada garis itu hanya akan membuat kita terpaku terhadap tulisan kita dan kita tidak bebas ketika ingin menggambar, justru nantinya takut akan memecah belah fokus kita. Terus kalau misalkan di background itu sangat sangat disarankan, karena ketika kita melakukan notaking kita akan mencatat beberapa kata hanya dalam satu halaman, jadi bukan beberapa kalimat tapi beberapa kata dalam satu kalimat. Dan kita harus ketahui bahwa seorang interpreter itu jangan sungkan-sungkan menggunakan kertas, karena ketika kita melakukan interpreting kita akan melakukan timbal balik dengan kertas. Kadang-kadang kita memberikan sesuatu kepada kertas dan kadang salah, dan kadang juga kertas tersebut memberikan sesuatu kepada kita. Jadi kita harus memberikan jangan ekonomikal, jangan pelit menggunakan kertas. Terus grammarizing, kita tidak harus menganalisis ataupun menganalisa segala sesuatu, tetapi kita hanya mencatat data-data yang penting.
As was obvious, we know when we've got we note once an idea has clearly taken shape in our mind. There will be some kind of time lag between what the speaker is saying and what we are noting. It may only be a split second, up to 5 seconds. In extreme cases, it can be 10 seconds. Because it takes that long for the interpreter really to get to grips with what the speaker is saying. But once he or she has got to grips with it, if they can then note it down neatly, economically, then that's better. Because they will have analyzed it, the idea will have taken shape in their mind, they will know what the speaker is saying. What? Everything. Some people can write very, very fast and note down very, very fast. But if you try to note down absolutely everything, even if you were superhuman, you would not manage it for long enough. It's not a human impossible. So we've got to be selective. So we can't note down everything, what do we note?
Yeah, we note things that are important.
One should note the things that one would tend to forget. That's rather easier said than done. Because also by definition, if it's the kind of thing that you would tend to forget, it is also the kind of thing that you tend to find difficult to note. So that is a problem, isn't it? The tendency to note those things that one would remember anyway. And the first step for solving that problem is to be aware that that is a problem that is working. We'll talk a bit about how to avoid that difference. Okay, so what we note is the essentials, I would say. And for me, the essentials are the linking things between ideas, the transitions between ideas. The things that tell you how one idea leads on to another, contrasts, contradicts it. Those are the joints in the skeleton of the speech. And if you know where the joints are, then you can actually fit the different bones together. But it's difficult identifying under the pressure of having to take notes, under the pressure of having to listen to something else. ideas, and there may be unfamiliar ideas. They may be expressed in rather difficult language for you. So you've got that difficult to begin with. On top of that, you've got to find some way of noting down those things that you've been talking about. Nobody said it was meant to be an easy job. Last question, how do we note? If we want the notepad to serve as something which is immediately accessible and enables us to trigger our recall of what we want to do, how should we note?
This is a sequence of union documentation. We use rules
Maybe. Not necessarily. I tend to agree with you. I use symbols quite freely. But I think that really is one step along the road. Let's go back to what we said before. The notepad has to serve to provide us with immediate access to our recollection of what the speaker said. Note-taking is not a matter of writing or writing. Because if you've written something like that, when you come to look at it on your notepad, you'll spend a certain amount of time deciphering it. You're not trying to produce a transcription of what the speaker says. You are trying to produce something which provides you with instantaneous access to what you already have. The layout of the ideas on the notepad must be such that this glance down at the notepad and find what you're looking for immediately. Even if you're able to produce something approaching a transcript on the notepad, it still would not enable you to do your job as an interpreter. Because as an interpreter, your primary duty is to communicate a message. And I think it would be almost impossible to communicate a message if you are having to read something and form a transcript on a notepad. It's very, very difficult to remain in touch with your audience. Don't forget, interpreting is a live activity where you have people who are hanging on your word. And those people don't want to. They won't pay attention to it for something really nice. You have to be in direct eye-to-eye contact with the people for whom you are working. And that means you can't afford to allow you to be sucked down by motion. So the notepad should really act as a trampoline. Often should have bounced. Go back to the lot of idea movement. Bounce off, glance down, single trigger off, and you're lucky. Danger, if you write too much, you don't write it in a clearly set out form. Danger is that far from being trampoline, you cannot have more of a quicksand. It just will suck you down. If you recommend you can do the job. Okay, that's all for theory.
Yang selanjutnya adalah akar. Akar kita melakukan teknik. Kita melakukan teknik kita dan sebuah jarak antara satu ibu dengan ibu yang lain. Nah ini menjadi sebuah kesempatan bagi kita untuk melakukan atau mencatat apa saja hal yang penting. Terus yang keempat. Yang keempat adalah apa? Apa yang harus kita catat? Kita sebagai manusia, kadang ada yang menulis itu dengan cepat, ataupun yang apa. Tapi yang cepat sekalipun, ketika menangkap sesuatu dari orang, itu tidak mungkin bisa mencatat semuanya. Jadi ada sesuatu hal yang harus kita pilih di dalam untuk apa yang harus kita teknik itu sendiri. Yang harus kita pilih adalah sesuatu yang mungkin kita lupa, yaitu sesuatu yang bersifat esensial dan bisa menghubungkan antara satu itu dengan yang lainnya. Ibaratnya kita dalam kerangka manusia, yaitu sebagai layout, layout itu ibaratkan satu gambaran yang bisa memberikan akses kita, akses yang bisa membantu kita untuk bisa menyampaikan pesan yang asli dan pesan yang disampaikan oleh narasumber kepada audiens. Kita melakukan hal itu bukan berarti kita menulis seperti biasa, tapi kita hanya menulis sesuatu yang esensial saja. Kan tadi kita mengetahui bahwa rating ini sebagai sesuatu yang bersifat penyedia akses bagi kita. Kita mengibaratkan rating ini itu ibarat sebuah trampolin. Ketika kita menggunakan trampolin, kita itu akan naik turun, loncat-loncat. Nah, kita harus seperti itu ketika melakukan rating ini. Jadi tidak harus mulu ke bawah gitu, berarti kita ke atas, ke bawah, ke atas. Bukan, kalau misalkan kita melakukan nantaging itu hanya fokus kepada nantaging, itu ibaratkan sebuah pasir risak, dimana pasir risak tersebut apabila kita duduk ataupun kita masuk ke dalamnya, kita akan terus terserang ke bawah yang pada akhirnya nanti kita tidak akan bisa muncul ke permukaan dan bisa menyampaikan apa yang ingin disampaikan oleh mas dulu kepada audiens. Dan itu merupakan suatu yang penting. Dan ini merupakan akhir dari sesi di mana seri tentang training ini sangat diperlukan untuk kalian yang